from WLWT, this is Issues.
Hello, welcome to Issues. I'm Jan Michelle Lemon Kearney of SESH Communications and the Cincinnati Herald. We have a really great show today. A little later, we're going to talk about the USO Tribute in Cincinnati, something you don't want to miss because they are honoring the men and women who serve our country. Also, it's time to get ready for the Midwest Regional Black Family Reunion. So much fun, 3 days of culture, fun. You don't want to miss that. So we're going to talk to Tracy Artis about that. First, we're going to talk about a really serious and really rather upsetting topic, and it's about youth suicide, but we're going to talk about prevention. And so let me introduce Dr. Marilyn Crumpton, who is our health commissioner for the city of Cincinnati, and Dr. Daniel Nelson, who's a child psychiatrist at Cincinnati Children's Hospital. Welcome both of you.
Thank you.
So I'm so glad you're here. And we were talking before about how the hotline that you gave last year was just, you know, burning up, like so many calls. And it sounds like suicide is on the rise with young people. Is that true?
That's true across the country. It really is. And young people are actually having more challenges than what we see with adults, where the suicide rate's actually been dropping.
Oh, so the suicide rates for older people is coming down. So why is it rising for youth?
Well, one of the things that we're trying to look at is what are the causes? And we know, based on a lot of research that's being done right now, that there are many adverse childhood experiences that our children are being subjected to. The term is ACEs, and that's one of the things we know is our children are in a very high stress situation in many situations.
Now, ACEs, what does that mean?
So it's adverse childhood experiences, and it's traumatic events that we know are going to create stress in a child's life.
And do you think maybe, is there a correlation with the rise in drug use? Like, you know, we're having that huge opioid problem, but that's across the country, but more so here. Is that affecting the suicide rate, do you think?
Well, high ACEs is actually correlated even to increased health problems throughout life. So children who undergo, like, witnessing a crime, such as a murder, children who've been physically or sexually abused, even going through divorce or other traumatic types of events, increases the risk for brain disease, mental health, but also physical health. So an increased incidence of childhood illnesses such as asthma or other stressful illnesses. So we really try to pay attention to getting children who are challenged by adverse events in their family life or in their community life, get them help and support. Certainly suicide is another factor for that.
Well, you know, so for teachers and parents and friends, what kinds of symptoms or behaviors should we look for?
Well, the biggest concern we have when it comes to suicidal behavior is usually depression or sometimes bipolar illness. Both those illnesses are associated with it.
Tell us about bipolar.
So bipolar is an illness that involves not just depression that's associated with suicidal behavior, but also having an increase in energy, thoughts going quickly, and often that can lead to enough dysregulation in the brain that the person can become psychotic and lose touch with reality. They begin to think they have special powers and they can do things.
And children almost act kind of manic.
Yeah, manic is the term. Bipolar and manic depression are really the same term for the same illness, the same brain disease. In children, often what you see, unlike adults who might, like I had one patient as an adult who told me he had played in Wimbledon, the Super Bowl, and the World Series.
And had he been in any
of
those?
No, he was not. But he really believed that he did, and that's how he saw himself, and he conducted himself that way. In children, it's more likely that they stop listening to adults. They begin to think they can do anything. They don't follow the rules, and they tend to have a marked degree of irritability, and they can quickly become violent and out of control, and that violence or aggression can be turned inward into suicidal behavior, destructive behavior.
Wow, so those are things we should look for in young people.
And the other thing to remember is, with children, not all children are giving us signs. So it's great to always know how at risk their circumstances are and be sensitive to looking for signs and concerns. And one of the things that, for example, that Cincinnati Public has done is partnered with MindPeace, which is a organization you've had here on your show.
Right. Susan came on and talked about MindPeace. That was great.
Yeah. And so what that has done partnering with the community mental health agencies, Children's Hospital, that mental health services have been made available inside all the Cincinnati public schools. And now that is expanding beyond Cincinnati Public, and I think it'll be pretty widely spread soon, right?
Yeah, they're moving up to Hamilton as well, and Susan and I met last week with the Archdiocese.
Oh,
we
wonderful.
Have the sixth largest archdiocese in the country, 42,000 children, and they've also been challenged by suicidal behavior. So
right.
It's the public schools have been challenged, and the partnership is real important. We've gone to the public schools. Some of the public schools have been more challenged than others. Some of the elementary schools have met with tragedy, as well as middle schools and
right,
high
and
schools.
Right, we've seen some of that in the news recently. And, you know, just for teenagers, for example, who will hear their friends talk about suicide, often they're told, don't tell anybody. Like, you know, here's what I'm thinking, but I don't want you to tell anybody. Shouldn't they go tell the parents? I mean, do they feel like they should have permission to go and tell an adult or a teacher?
It's a safety issue. So the message, I guess the most important message we feel like we need to get out is if anyone expresses any comments that make us think that there might be a risk of suicide, tell someone that can help. If you're a child, go to an adult, talk with them. Don't stop until someone who's going to respond and find out if that risk is imminent makes an appropriate intervention, because that's how we save lives.
And let's give a phone number, because there's also a hotline. I think it's Two Children's Hospital. So tell us that number, Dr. Nelson.
So it's called the PERC number, the Psychiatric Emergency Response Center number. Now that would be for a very severe acute response where you feel a child's really in trouble.
Okay.
If you have questions, it's really lovely to go to the MindPeace website, because
Now let's talk about the Youth Suicide Prevention line, just because it's up on the screen.
Well, that's our local line.
That's
actually for
line.
Children's Hospital.
Okay.
There's a national suicide line that you can pull off of the internet, and I think Marilyn has the phone number here for the national suicide support line.
Which and you is, know, let me just interrupt for a second. So for those listening on the radio, because we haven't said the number out loud, but it's 513-636-4124. That's Youth Suicide Prevention, the local hotline, 636-4124.
Now, and that would be for a child who's in acute crisis. You need to get them in the hospital right away.
Okay.
If it's not acute, then calling agencies like Lighthouse, St. Joe's, St. Al's, all these local agencies. And then MindPeace has an excellent web page. So does the National Center for School Crisis and Bereavement. And the National Suicide Hotline is 800-273-8255.
Okay, 800-273-8255. Okay, thank you so much, both. You'll have to come back. Really
Great.
Important topic, and thank you for sharing that information with us. Really important.
Thank you, Jen.
Thank you.
Stick with us. We'll be back in a minute to talk about the USO tribute. There is a great organization, and I know you're familiar with it, the USO, serving the men and women who serve our country, who are serving us. And so let me introduce to you two folks who are organizing a USO Tribute Cincinnati fundraiser, and it's Dwayne Hickerson, who is a Marine. Dwayne Hickerson. Okay, you're Dwayne Hickerson. I'm sorry, I got you two mixed up. All right, this is Dwayne Hickerson, and you are with USO Tribute Cincinnati.
That's right.
And then Michael Logue, and you're actually co-chair of the Cincinnati Tribute, and you are a former Marine.
Yes.
But I guess once a Marine, always a Marine.
That's right.
No such thing as a
correct.
Former Marine. Semper
That's right.
Fi. Okay.
That's right. Always a Marine.
Well, welcome, both of you. Thank you so much.
Thank
so
you.
Let's talk a little bit about the USO, because we were talking with Diana Lara earlier, and how so many people think, well, the government gives you money. Is that right?
No, it's a total charity, 501c3. All of our dollars are from corporate donations and private citizens. So. We're always looking for monies in order to do the good that we think we do.
Right. And just going back to the history, so it's been around since
1941.
Right.
It was a group of charities at the time, and then
okay.
it is now just the USO. And we have charter centers all over the country. We have over 200 centers globally.
Wow.
We have exclusive access to all the military installations and personnel, which allows us to provide the services that the military needs. And it's
and let's talk about some of those, because I mean, we know, I think when most of us think about USO, we go back to like Bob Hope over there with the shows and all that, and that's really important. But there are also some medical things. Walter Reed Hospital, tell us about that, Michael.
Yeah, so you know, talking about it from service members' perspective, the USO to myself, other soldiers, sailor, airmen, and Marines, is it's an extension of home. And when you're further deployed somewhere in the world and you see a USO center or package, you know, something wonderful is inside. You know, in my case, if it's, you know, your first shower in 45 days and there's a shower kit inside, you know, or local artwork from a kindergarten in your hometown, it's really tremendous. And it's tremendous because the USO volunteers, they really care and they treat you like their family because they know that we're America's family. So as this comes, you know, from the USO being strategically located at places for service members when they deploy, it's the last piece of home that they see. And when they come home, it's the first piece of home that
wow.
they see. And for some of, you know, for some of our service members, so myself, we served with Lima Company out of Columbus, Ohio, a group of local Marines, 184 of us deployed in 2005, and we did great work throughout the Al-Anbar province in Iraq, but it came at a
cost.
And
thank you for your service. No. We really
my absolute honor to be
that.
Able to serve. Trust me, it's my absolute honor to serve.
I mean, it's a huge sacrifice, and
the big sacrifice that I've seen is on the families. So the 184 Marines that deployed locally, 24 were killed. And another 27 were wounded, and you know, far most severely wounded, they began a medical evac. Trip that for most of them ends at Walter Reed or Fort Belvoir, and that's where our nation's most severely wounded is. The average stay is 30 months. So if you think about any time you've ever been in the hospital,
30 months.
Yeah.
Oh.
You think of any time you've ever been in the hospital for one night, two nights, and your
so
family is
home.
Visiting.
Yeah.
So those are the tremendous services that the USO is strategically there to be on site at Walter Reed and Fort Belvoir. And Dwayne can tell you about the construction and what we did building into the Warrior Centers there
That's
to
right.
support
our
the families.
Our monies from USO Tribute Cincinnati helped build two new Warrior Centers, one at Fort Belvoir and one at Walter Reed National Military Medical Center.
That's fantastic.
And these are beautiful facilities. They have art rooms, the music rooms,
wow.
and so
fantastic.
So our returning men and women that are struggling can photography, painting.
Well, let's just say this, so people can see all the great things USO is doing, and we have a chance to actually contribute and help by supporting the USO Tribute Cincinnati. Tell us when and where it's going to be, and how do we get it? How do we get tickets?
We have a great event on Sunday, September 3rd, at the Boathouse.
Yeah, Montgomery and Boathouse.
Montgomery and Boathouse.
Love those ribs.
You can't beat that. It's Riverfest Fireworks Night.
Oh, fun.
We start at 4 o'clock, and you can get tickets. You can get tickets, usotributecincinnati.com.
Okay, usotributecincinnati.com, and we'll link people
and
to WLWT.com.
On there. If you have questions, you can email in via that site, and we'll answer everything you need.
So we can come, we can have barbecue, we can watch the fireworks, and we're supporting USO, United
and we
Services
honor our,
Organization.
And we honor our military, and we have 5 honorees that we will honor that night.
Oh, okay.
2 from World War II, 1 from Vietnam,
wonderful.
And 2 active duty military, which we'll announce those in August.
Oh, that's fantastic. So you have to come back in August and tell us, and
okay,
then,
we'd love
or you
to
know,
do
or
it.
We can announce it. We'll just make sure people get the word out.
Thank you.
Because we really want people.